forever to touch you, 'cause I know that you feel me somehow. You're the closest to heaven that I'll ever be, and I don't wanna go home right now. And all I could taste is this moment, and all I can breathe is your life. Sooner or later it's over. I just don't want to miss you tonight. And I don't want the world to see me, 'cause I don't think that they'd understand. When everything's made to be broken, I just want you to know. Tears that ain't coming, all the moment of truth in your lies. When everything feels like the movies, yeah, you bleed just to know you're alive.
Hard to say that I'd rather stay awake when I'm asleep, 'cause today this could be the greatest day of our lives. Before it all ends, before we run out of time, stay close to me. Stay close to me. Watch the world come alive tonight. Stay close to me. Tonight this could be the greatest night of our lives. Let's make a new start. The future is ours to find. Can you see it? Can you see it in my eyes? Can you feel it now? Can you hold it in your arms tonight?
Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
I do.
Thank you. Please be seated. A very warm welcome to Buchanan Church, although it's not all that warm. And there's some things that are out of our control, even as a church. Billy Graham used to say that there's only one place that prayer doesn't work, and that's on the golf course. And I agree with him. I've tried it. It doesn't work. And the other thing that's off the radar is the weather when it comes to prayer. So we've just got to put up with Scottish weather. But we'll have a great time, and it will be a joyful day. I'm absolutely sure of that. So a very, very warm welcome to Laura and Steve's wedding. We're going to support them in every way, and we're going to sing our hearts out this afternoon as we join together. For all things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small. Please be seated. So very, very warm welcome. We're here as family and friends to support Laura and Steve. And we remind ourselves that we're in the presence of God, who offers us his love and support. We remind ourselves too that marriage is a gift of God and a means of grace. And in the lifelong union of marriage, we can know the joy of God. In Christian marriage, husband and wife are called to live faithfully together, to love each other with respect and with tenderness and with delight. We're going to join together in prayer, and then we're going to have our marriage ceremony. Let us pray. Eternal God and our loving Heavenly Father, we bow our heads in your presence. We thank you for the joy of this day. We thank you for the beauty of this very moment in time. And we thank you for all the plans and preparations that have been made by the family that have brought us to this moment in time. And we thank you for Laura and Steve and for their deep love for each other. And we thank you for this step of commitment that they're taking just to put a seal on that love, on their relationship, on their friendship. And so we pray that they would know your love and blessing this day and all the days of their life. And we ask that you would be with us, that you would lead us by your grace and by your mercy. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would the congregation please stand? And Laura and Steve, I'm going to ask you if you would take your vows today before God and before your family and friends. If you would say after me, I, Stephen Neil Gordon.
I, Stephen Neil Gordon.
Now take you, Laura Victoria Gillespie.
Now take you, Laura Victoria Gillespie.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
In the presence of God.
In the presence of God.
And before this congregation.
And before this congregation.
I promise to be a loving.
I promise to be a loving.
Faithful and loyal husband to you.
Faithful and loyal husband to you.
All the days of my life.
All the days of my life.
Thank you. And Laura, if you can compose yourself. It's seriously emotional up here. We all feel it. If you could say after me, I, Laura Victoria Gillespie.
I, Laura Victoria Gillespie.
Now take you, Stephen Neil Gordon.
Now take you, Stephen Neil Gordon.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
In the presence of God.
In the presence of God.
And before this congregation.
And before this congregation.
I promise to be a loving.
I promise to be a loving.
Faithful and loyal wife to you.
Faithful and loyal wife to you.
All the days of my life.
All the days of my life.
Laura and Steve, as a token of the covenant into which you have entered, the rings will be given and received. And I'm the only one allowed to talk about it. Only joking. Steve, if you would put Laura's ring on. Okay, and if you would put Steve's on. Okay, well done. By this sign, what you have done, you take each other to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish so long as you both shall live. You've taken your vows this afternoon before God and before your family and friends and this congregation. And so it gives me great pleasure now to announce you to be husband and wife. And Steve, you may kiss the new bride and you may cheer, yeah. What a great moment that is. And I mean, I've done this about 500 times, but it always just gets me, this moment. It's just absolutely fabulous. But that's enough for just... Would you like to sit down? But you guys are still standing.
Yeah, I'm still standing.
Okay, yeah. Okay, I'm going to ask Steve's sister if she would come forward and read. And maybe we can just move to one side so that we can... Louise. That would be great.
This reading's from Winnie the Pooh by A.A. Milne. "Pooh," whispered Piglet. "Yes, Piglet," replied Pooh. "Nothing. I just wanted to be sure of you. If you live to be 100, I want to live to be 100 minus one day, so I never have to live without you. It's so much more friendly with two. Pooh, promise me you won't forget about me, ever. Not even when I am 100. Pooh thought for a little. "How old shall I be then?" 99. Pooh nodded. "I promise," he said. "Some people care too much. I think it's called love."
Okay, thank you. And if you would just kind of like to close back in so you hide me, that would be great. Okay, I love this moment, even although I've been up here up front so many times. And over the years, I've given a number of different talks. I love this time when I can just say something to the new bride and groom that I hope is going to be helpful for this moment in time and also for the years ahead. And I've got some talks that I kind of really feel, I'm drawn to this. And one that I really enjoy doing, I'm going to do, and I enjoy doing it because it involves someone in the congregation or audience coming forward to help me to do this. So I'm going to choose someone in a second. It'll be a guy, so ladies, don't worry. But I want to read this little lesson first, and this builds up the suspense in the lesson, you know, because I got all your attention now because guys are saying, I wonder if it's going to be me. Hope it's going to be me. Okay, right. The reading is from Ecclesiastes chapter 4, and it's a fairly short reading. "Two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. Also, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken." A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. And I'm just kind of scanning faces to see who I think would be the most appropriate in case no one volunteers for this. So I've got one or two ideas. I'll tell you the kind of person I'm looking for. I'm looking for someone who's fairly young and quite strong, healthy. I've got my man here. Right. Would you be willing to help out?
Yes, yeah, of course.
Is that okay with the other guys in the congregation? Okay, right. Okay, that's absolutely fine. Now, we didn't plan this ahead. He has no idea what he's going to do. No idea at all. But he's kind of strong. Do you play rugby or you?
No.
But you have a very strong-looking physique. So you're just the guy. Okay. All right, so remember this reading, two are better than one. Two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. And this is so easy for you. Would you just demonstrate how easily you can break that little cord? Yeah. Little response from folks. Yeah. Okay. That's enough. Okay. Right. That was kind of easy for him. So what we're going to do is give him two strands. Think he'll do this?
Two strands.
And we'll just kind of weave them together like that.
It's competition. Weave them together.
Don't you know? Well, we know you can break one, and I've kind of got a feeling that this will be pretty easy for you. Okay?
You have to do it in front of everyone.
Consent. Do that.
Yeah! Right. Joe, this guy, so I've got a feeling I could give him five, and he's still going to do it. So, three, and I haven't got any more here. Okay, right, I've got my two strands, and he's shown how easy it is to break these. And, you know, when I get a bit of spare time, I love to go fishing. And I've got some invisible fishing line here that I've tied onto these two cords. And what I'm going to do, just so that you know the deal here, I'm just going to weave this. Can you hold that bit there?
Yeah, no problem.
And I'm just going to weave into these two cords a little bit of invisible fishing line.
That's cheating.
Okay. Do you think you'll do it?
No.
I mean, you're not allowed to jerk it, but...
It slips my fingers off.
But don't hurt yourself.
Can't do it.
You can't do it.
No, honestly,
you really tried?
Yeah, I really tried.
Yeah. I'm pleased about that, because it would have just wrecked this talk if you'd done it. No. I mean, Hercules would have trouble breaking this.
Thor.
And it's all because... it's all because of the invisible fishing line. So you're saying, Alec, what's the point in this? Well, here's the point. That when a three-chord strand cannot be easily broken, and when that third chord is the invisible presence of Almighty God, then that is just an amazing relationship and strength that God brings into your life. So what I'm saying is, here's the point, that you allow God to weave his joy and his power and his peace and his love and his grace into your lives, that as you grow in your relationship together, that you invite God to be there too. And as that trio, Steve and Laura and the invisible presence of Almighty God, then you've got great strength and great hope and a great future. And that's my message to you, just to invite God to be part of your life from this day forward, to be with you in all the highs and lows and ups and downs of life. And he will do that. Let's bow our heads and give God thanks for this time together. You are an amazing God, and we thank you. Though we cannot see you, we know that you are with us and that you love us and that you gave your Son Jesus to be our Savior and Lord and Redeemer. And we bless you for this day and this really, really special time in Buchanan Church. Thank you for all the guests here and family, and just pray that they would really enjoy the rest of this day. And especially we thank you for Steve and Laura and their love for each other. Just be with them, and may they know your blessing from this moment in time, every day of their lives. We commend them to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I thought the singing was amazing. It was really, really good. So let's keep that standard up, and we'll sing our second hymn. One more step along the world I go.
One more step along the world I go.
And you can be seated and you'll be entertained for the next few minutes by this lovely, wonderful quartet. And we are going to go through and sign the marriage schedule. Okay.
Ooh. You're a part-time lover and a full-time friend. The monkey on your back is the latest trend. I don't see what anyone can see in anyone else but
you. I kiss you on the brain in the shadow of the train. Kiss you all starry-eyed, my body swinging from side to side. I don't see what anyone can see in anyone else but
here is the church and here is the steeple. We sure are cute for two ugly people. I don't see what anyone can see in anyone else but
the pebbles forgive me, the trees forgive me. So why can't you forgive me? I don't see what anyone could see in anyone else but
I will find my niche in your car with my MP3 DVD rumble pack guitar. I don't see what anyone can see in anyone else but up, up, down, down, left, right, B, A, start. Just because we use cheats doesn't mean we're not smart. I don't see what anyone can see in anyone else but
you. You are always trying to keep it real. I'm in love with how you feel. I don't see what anyone can see in anyone else but
we both have shiny happy fits of rage. You want more fans, I want more stage. I don't see what anyone can see in anyone else but
Don Quixote was a steel driving man. My name is Adam, I'm your biggest fan. I don't see what anyone can see in anyone else but
squinched up your face and did a dance. Shook a little turd out of the bottom of your pants. I don't see what anyone can see in anyone else but you.
Firstly, I'd like to introduce the father of the bride, Lindsay Gillespie. For all those fans of EastEnders, you might liken him to Eddie Moon. He's also the man that brought us such hits as Hold Me Close, Gonna Make You a Star, and Stardust, aka Mr. David Essex. Please put your hands together for the father of the bride, Mr. Lindsay, or to his friends better known as Linus Gillespie.
Thanks, Robbie. I see we have four cameras, so no pressure then.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and Cass, we've let Cass sit in tonight because of the rain. For those of you who don't know, it's okay. I've known him since we were four, and he can take it. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Lindsay, father of the beautiful bride, Laura. And on behalf of my equally beautiful wife, Agnes, or should I say beautiful and long-suffering wife, Agnes, and the groom's parents, Alison and Donald, can I say how delighted we are to welcome friends and relatives of both families to our home to celebrate the marriage of Laura and Stephen, aka Lola Bud and Steve-O. And don't they make a fine couple? Yay! Agnes and I are genuinely delighted to welcome such a charming young man as Steve to our family. Most of you have travelled a long way to get here, from England, from Singapore, from Hong Kong, from America, and Fedundi. Hey! Did I get that right? No. Thank you for coming, and we hope that you enjoy the rest of the evening. May I also take this opportunity to say a huge thank you to all those who have helped us with the preparation for today, and you know who you are. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm a married man, so I don't often get the chance to speak uninterrupted for this long. I'll try to keep it short, but don't get your hopes up. I can't tell you how proud I feel standing here today as father of the bride. And doesn't she look absolutely stunning? I was there when Lola was born, directing operations and keeping the medics right. Then I watched as she grew into the beautiful young woman that you see before you now. We've had our fair share of dramas along the way, including a police-escorted dash to hospital, a lip bitten clean through, and being so relieved that Laura and friends left Koh Phi Phi the day before the tsunami struck. There is more later on Action Girl. For the sake of brevity, I will skip the school years, except to say that Laura is pretty academic. In fact, she's pretty and academic. She's never far from a book. Laura never admitted to having boyfriends, although spookily there were plenty of boys around most of the time. I remember the first time I met Steve was in Mosquito, a bar in...
Mosquito table.
Let's hear it for the Mosquito staff. where Laura and Steve both used to work. It was a slightly awkward moment, because although I'd heard that Steve might be the right man, it was a chance meeting, but we got along fine. Later, when Lola and Steve were setting off on their world tour from Glasgow Airport, Steve took me aside and reassuringly said, "Don't worry, I'll look after her for you." That touched me, and I haven't forgotten thinking, he'll do. In the event, however, I'm not sure who did the looking after during that, trip. Behave yourself. I was also impressed that Steve formally asked me for Laura's hand. For his own good reasons, considerable time passed before he let Laura into the secret. But as you can see, he got the right answer. I can tell you from my point of view, it wasn't easy keeping that secret, and boy was I in trouble when the news got out. On the subject of Steve, I understand that his rugby chums, and in particular his best men, the Chuckle Brothers over there, found it challenging to dig any dirt whatsoever on our groom. Not me, however. I didn't have very far to look. It wasn't that long ago when Agnes and I had settled down to watch Steve play rugby with Glasgow Hawks on telly. The first thing we saw was the bold Steve being sin-binned. Admittedly for the first time, but that's not the point. Any dirt is good dirt when there's no dirt around. Then there is the Hawks calendar. Well, may you laugh, because that's the calendar that Agnes keeps showing to her friends. And Steve, that was indeed a novel place to park a rose. Did you manage to remove all the thorns from your butt cheeks? So much for dirt. Lola and Steve now live and work in Singapore. But before that, as I mentioned, they had themselves a wee world tour, including South America, Australia, Cambodia, Thailand, South Africa, and the Galapagos Islands. There's only one person who perhaps has seen more of the world, and that has to be David Attenborough. And who can forget the travel blogs? They're really interesting and great if you can't get to sleep. Anyway, back to Laura. As I said, she's a bit of a Lara Croft and has tried golfing, horse riding, bungee jumping, abseiling, whitewater rafting, cuddling tigers, riding elephants, skydiving, and whittling. They really like whittling. In explanation, they both bounded in one Saturday evening and proceeded to whittle each other lucky charms out of lumps of wood. Aww. I also believe that Lola is now a trapeze artist. And somewhere between school and all of that stuff, she qualified as a chartered accountant. No slouch, you would think, but Laura can sleep for Scotland anywhere, anytime. And come to think of it, so can Steve, even when you're talking to him.
That's just you, Lindsay.
On the personality side, Laura has more friends than I can count, both here and in Singapore, and many are here tonight. She can party with the best of them, and she is no mean shopper. She even wears some of the clothes that she buys. It also has to be said that Laura is a tad stubborn, and I've really no idea where that came from. Have you, Agnes?
Nope.
Lola also has a dark side. I remember the time when, at the tender age of 5, we went into her room, found her holding her sister Emma's cuddly Snoopy toy with a comb to his throat, like that. Emma had obviously upset her in some way, and Laura said with a sinister tone, "Move and the dog gets it." Anyway, just before I finish, may I say that Agnes and I are so pleased that through Stephen, we now have two friends in Alison and Donald. And at this point, it is traditional to give our couple some words of advice on marriage. So remember this, Lola and Steve, don't go to sleep in an argument, stay up and fight. Laura, you will always be our baby, and your mum and I love you more than the whole wide world. And you know that. I'm sure that I speak for all of us in this room when I wish you and Stephen a long and happy life together. Ladies and gentlemen, it's now my privilege to ask you to be upstanding and raise your glasses. The toast is the bride and groom, Laura and Stephen, Mr. and Mrs. Gordon. Thank you.
Well done.
Hello, everyone. As most of you know, I'm quite the shy and retiring type, so I'm going to keep this short and sweet. I want to make sure that everyone has their glasses fully charged because there's going to be a large number of toasts. Let's see who can keep up. I'm also going to be keeping my eyes open for anyone playing wedding bingo. This table here. Anyone who's drawn thank yous in for a world of pain. First of all, my wife and I... It's always an easy opener. We'd like to thank each and every one of you for being here today. We're so lucky to know so many fantastic people and have you all with us here today as well. We deliberately didn't have a top table, so you'll have to guess who gave us the best presents. There are, of course, some notable mentions. Justin Reed, Donna Lau, Lexi and Tony Pepperdine. Love you guys. From Singapore, thanks very much. The four of you, and notable mention to Bundy and Rachel as well, six of them have made our time in Singapore to date some of the best time of our lives, and we're so delighted you could be here today. Sam and Eli from Copenhagen, last time we saw you guys was on your wedding day. Since then you've added Noah to your family, and we're also delighted you can make it. Gillian McGuire, from Abu Dhabi, furthest member away from of Laura's family. Thanks for coming. Katrina, Simon, Jude, Lola, and wee Ruby, all the way from LA. Those guys just flew in just yesterday, so their jet lag is helping them stay up until the wee hours, so no excuses. Ali Heed McClay, all the way from Hong Kong, what answer? More to follow on him. And everyone else from around the UK, all the way from Elgin in the north, from Hove to the south. So many people have travelled from around the world to be here today, and we're truly, truly grateful for your presence. We're also very glad you could be here. No? Too subtle? Too subtle? Okay, moving swiftly. Special mention also goes to Gillian and Jolene. Congratulations. Gillian is due in 3 weeks' time, so everyone must offer her a seat later in the evening, and you'll be very popular. So congratulations to you guys as well. Quick thanks to Louise for doing the reading in the church today. It has to be said that the reading was Laura and my choice, but she drew the line actually doing the voices. So thanks very much. Also, a very happy birthday to Claire Little. Yay! Happy 21st, again. So everyone, wish her please a happy birthday from buy her a drink. And so my first toast, you don't have to be upstanding for this one, is to everyone here today. To everyone. Moving swiftly on, I'd like to thank my parents, Donald and Alison Gordon, beside me, for being here today and being here for me throughout my life. They've set such a fine example of how married and family life should be. I can only wish that Laura and I can enjoy all of the happiness that you have in your lives together. This is usually the time where there'd be a small bouquet, but they've apparently gone not AWOL. So it's a small bouquet. Thank you very much, Kamal. Second toast of the evening to Donald Nelson. I want to thank Laura's parents, Lindsay and Agnes, for an unbelievable number of things. First of all, kindly allowed us the use of their garden. I wish you could see more of it. But through their tireless efforts, it looks as good as it does today, but as I said, it's maybe a bit wet. Lindsay would absolutely hate me to tell you the hard work and stress that's gone into it, but it's made Laura, and particularly Laura, very, very happy, so that's the right outcome. Thank you so much. Agnes and Lindsay have been incredible in everything they've done for us. Hopefully you'll get rid of at least some of our stuff in storage at some point. I also want to thank them for producing Laura. And giving their approval for our wedding day today. Some say I might have been foolish, but Lindsay was on my stag do last week, so I'm actually delighted that approval still stands.
Am I not still on it?
Yeah, it still stands. It was also Lindsay's birthday yesterday, which she's very kindly agreed to forfeit until next year. So, I have another bouquet to present to the lovely Agnes Gillespie.
Cool.
Thank you so much.
You don't get it.
No, I want to give her a wee kiss.
Full of water. You want to sit over there?
For the third toast, to Agnes and Lindsay. And now I get to my wonderful wife, who looks absolutely beautiful today. Best day of my life. Can't say her brother. I can't say how lucky I am to be married now to Laura. We've done some incredible things today, and together, just throughout our time together, and I can categorically say she's the most positive, thoughtful, and loving person I've ever met. You're my best friend, and I love you so much. Made her cry. I can't wait to spend the rest of my life with you. These have been the absolute best years of my life, and there'll be many more to follow. We've been around the world together, but if you ask me, the adventure's just about to start. Number four, to Laura. Mrs. Gordon. I'm of course duty bound to thank my ushers, Callum Rankin and Robbie Grieve, and my best men, Jack Bannerman and Ali McClay, for their help and efforts in the run-up to today, and also on the day itself. So thanks, guys. Love you. I haven't actually heard Jack and Ali's speech yet, so this still may be retracted. A better bunch of guys you're not likely to see any. Hello? Yep. Back. A better bunch of guys you're not likely to see anywhere, and I'm genuinely happy to know them and call them my friends. Jack and Ali have made a fantastic best man team, and have just about made up the whole brain required to plan a stag team, with the three of us spread over. there's a lot of air in there. Just about made up the whole brain, with the three of us spread over Hong Kong, London and Singapore. So that's about three countries and 6,000 miles. So, honourable mention to Justin Reed, who helped significantly in the organisation of the Asian stag, which we'll leave it at that. So, the second last toast to the ushers and best men.
Ushers and best men.
Finally, and I promise this is final, I'd like to thank all of Laura's bridesmaids. India Fullerton, Emma Gillespie, Claire Thine and Donna Lau. Also looking absolutely beautiful today. Look beautiful. Laura has amazing friends from all walks of life, and I know she loves you all very, very much. And we're all delighted that you could be here today. So the final toast, and the only one that as a groom I'm allowed to give, is to the bridesmaids.
To the bridesmaids.
And now I reluctantly have to hand the microphone to two other gents who you should never listen to and who should heckle as much as you like. Thank you very much.
Well done.
Have a great evening.
Okay. This works. This is the first. This is a start. Mr. and Mrs. Gillespie, Mr. and Mrs. Gordon, is there any McPherson here? No, he's not, okay, not him. Beautiful bridesmaids, ushers, the extended Gillespies, the extended Gordons, other friends, and of course, Mr. and Mrs. Stephen and Laura Gordon. Yay! It's not a joke, but that's one of 543. We thought the day may never come, but I'm glad Stephen's eventually admitted to everyone who is the best man. More correctly, the better man. We would like to get some of the formalities out of the way before we start. On behalf of the bridesmaids, Claire, Donna, Emma and India, I'd like to say thank you, Laura and Stephen, for letting me be part of this very special day. And don't they look absolutely stunning? I believe Laura would have been lost without them over the past few months. So, can we actually have another cheer for the bridesmaids from everyone? The volume of support from all of them, including Mrs. Gordon and Mrs. Gillespie, and not forgetting the two dads, has been immense. And if it wasn't for the efforts from the majority of the top table, well, there's not a top table, but everyone here, plus a few more, the wedding wouldn't look like it was today. Laura Gordon. Doesn't that sound swell? And don't you look absolutely beautiful? All the boys in the room will agree with me that it's such a sad day for us that such a wonderful girl has been taken officially off the market. And I must also say, and every girl will agree with me, that Stephen Neil Gordon is just another day. So, that's the formalities out of the way. There's a couple of telegrams have come in from people that couldn't make it. Gordo and Lola, we're so sorry we weren't able to join you on your special day, but we'll be sure to raise a glass for you from Singapore. You're an awesome couple who in a short time have become great friends. Congrats to both of you for looking forward to seeing you soon. P.S. Gordo, thanks for being the only person in Singapore who makes me look remotely tanned. Love, Webbing and Lottie. Murray and Joan from Dubai. Congratulations, Mr. and Mrs. G, Hope you had a wonderful day so far. Gutted we couldn't sneak away from the desert to be with you tonight for a jig and a swally. Wishing you both much love and happiness for your future together, as in June. I'll now hand over to, I would call him the worst man, he's not actually, he's actually the other best man, champion guy, Jack Barron.
Thank you very much. I'm Jack, for those who don't know me. And I like to start off a speech, like I start off all my other best man speeches, with these three strings. And I'd like Ali to... I don't know if you know these guys, but this is a... I'll see if you can break together. Them. There's three of them. I want to see if you can break them to start off with. Now, it's very flattering and interesting you asked me a few words about Steve. You'd think that him getting married was a sign of him starting to make good life decisions. And yet he's chosen someone as his best man who is terrified of speaking in the public. I wish I had the ability to express how truly grateful I am for that, so thank you, Steve. And if the speech does go badly, we'll know soon enough. Because Steve will vote with his eyes and do what he does best, fall asleep. The fact that he's been managed to stay awake through his own wedding is something of a miracle and shows to the extent to which he clearly loves you, Laura. Yes, as is customary for any best man, I've done all my research via the internet, and I'm well aware too that it's traditional to embarrass the groom, to dig out the most humiliating and discomforting stories, which though funny, can leave some form of lasting mark on a friendship. Sadly, as the few of you don't know Steve, will quickly realise he's not left me much to work with. There are in fact no bad stories about Steve. Indeed, if I'm being honest, writing the whole speech is not entirely pleasurable. You see, when you troll through a life of a man who's so irritatingly close to perfection as Steve is, you at least hope they have the good grace and decency to leave something behind that suggests they're kind of a difficult person behind it all. Is that the case with Steve? No. You know what everyone's ever known Steve's got to say? Well, Steve's great. Oh well, Steve's just a good guy, Jack, I've got nothing on him. Oh, my favourite, Steve's lovely. Literally, no material. Clearly though, it's no coincidence I nicknamed Steve back in school Ned Flanders, the straight-laced Christian from The Simpsons. You may have a little chuckle there, but trust me, if you spent a few weeks placing your life next to Steve's, you wouldn't find it funny. You'd realise you're more of a Homer Simpson, or in my case, Mo. Now, I met Steve when I was 5, and although he hadn't quite started shaving, I was still impressed by his level of physical maturity. While I was still interested in burning my sisters My Little Ponies, Steve was riding real horses, hair flowing in the wind, bare-chested. Now that's the kind of kid you want to be pals with, and I personally made sure I was by his side as often as possible. No one wants to mess with a 12-year-old who's got a six-pack and nicknamed The Body. So where's the dirt on Steve, I hear you ask? Well, I asked his parents for something juicy, I could tell you, and it seems the most embarrassing thing about him, aside from being the son of a solicitor and a librarian and marrying an accountant, my, those long winter nights are just gonna fly. Is the fact that his mum was better at Tetris when he was 12 years old. Not exactly the strippers and crystal meth stories I was looking for. So as I mentioned, bad stories are hard to come by when it comes to Steve. But one episode continued to rear its ugly head from Steve's behind in the lunch queue at Dundee High School cafeteria one day. Sorry, give me a second. I'm going there.
Compose yourself.
Yeah. It was a lunch queue as mundane as any other, until Steve, while casually talking to me, attempted a cautious release of gas. No crime there, I hear you say. But within seconds, Steve's face had turned bright red, and then I knew his pants were brown. I knew what had happened. Was Steve humiliated? No. Instead, he gave two casual flicks of his legs and released what can only be described as a very solid and perfectly formed nugget of poo. which evacuated Steve's leg and scurried by and around a nearby table. Situation dealt with. Such skills might suggest that Steve could have been a footballer. But as we all know, rugby was his game. Let's have a great big round of applause for Steve's glittering rugby career. Which sadly never happened. We all knew he could have made it right to the top, but unfortunately, like Tiger Woods, injuries blighted his chances. But Steve's no one-trick pony. He was an amazing actor in a number of theatre and musical production roles in his younger years, the pinnacle being Joseph in the Technicolor Dreamcoat, in which he took the lead, thus following in the footsteps of his idols, Jason Donovan, his lookalike Gary Barlow, and Dale Winton. He also starred in high school production Guys and Dolls, which for Stephen might as well be called Guys or Dolls, considering how much he looks like his sister. That's right, Steve. Now, how much ripped, muscly, or built you get, you're always going to look like a woman. Do we not mention how big and Steve, how big and tough Steve is yet? Well, he's never been tougher than when he sang Limp Bizkit, or should I say rapped, in front of the whole school, in front of the headmaster, and in front of the entire school, said the F word. That's right. Good guy Steve did that. Swearing in public. Now there's a guy with big fucking balls. Sorry, Steve. Today, though, is about love. And I'm delighted to say that Steve's a hopeless romantic. He's so versed in the art of love that he once tried to sign off his Valentine's card in Spanish. Unfortunately, rather than putting Connie Moore Stephen, he wrote Amo Stephen, thus telling the girl in question, with love, Stephen, but rather, I love Stephen. Which may well be the case, but why do you tell her? All I do know is this. I can't think of anyone who's more deserved to be happy than Steve. Joking aside, it can't be easy meeting such a kind, thoughtful, and well-liked bloke. Otherwise, we'd all be like that. Steve is special and deserves to be as happy as Laura clearly makes him, which must make the fact that she's pretty special too. So on behalf of everyone, I wish you both the very best and stay in touch, because we all need the good guys in our life, or in my case, money. So I'd like to raise a glass, which I don't have one, and to Steve and Laura.
Steve and Laura.
I'll pass you now.
Sorry everyone, I'm back on. I know, no pressure. That's very good, Jack. Jeez. I expected to get so many laughs. Tears. Well, I'm sure some may have been surprised, just like us, to hear we were given the responsibility of being Stephen's best men. When Stephen asked us, we were extremely excited, more so about the stag party. And then we began to wonder, what are our duties as a best man? I found a book at home, Wedding Etiquette Properly Explained, a great insight into all major aspects of organising a wedding 30 plus years ago. Well, regardless, how much could it really have changed? It describes the choosing of a best man and his many duties. First sentence of the second paragraph, this should be done with extreme care. It proceeded to tell me the duties would be onerous. I thought to myself, this does not look good. He would have roles of being an MC, a chief usher, a toastmaster, have flair for organisation, and have limitless tact. It doesn't stop there, the hiring of the cars, baggage master, taking the groom to the wedding on time, leading the ushers to their duties, and the safeguarding of the wedding ring. The only good thing it said, that I was going to accompany the chief bridesmaid. I thought again, it's not so bad after all. None of the aforementioned roles Stephen has even slightly considered. He's withdrawn our MC role, our chief usher role, toastmaster, a flair for organisation. Yes, I've got flair. Organisation? Absolutely not. And I have a near enough zero tact. I'm organising anything. I live on the other side of the world, making sure the groom gets there. That wasn't part of it, sorry. I like to be fashionable, and that means late. And the safeguard.
Yeah.
That's how, oh yeah, here, we're back. Sorry, that was a satellite orbiting my massive planet. Now that the aforementioned role Stephen has even slightly considered, he's removed all his role, blah, 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 and I near have zero tact. Anyway, and the safeguarding of the wedding ring. No one in their right mind, or left on for that matter, would even describe me or Jack, let alone responsible, let alone for a wedding ring. Having gone through all of the above considerations, we thought, how is Stephen going to be such a wonderful and loving husband if he's been so irresponsible to choose Jack and I as his best men? But more to the point, how will Laura put up with him, you know, if he continues in this vein? Thinking extremely hard, we were thinking of things this man has done wrong in all the time we've known him, described by many as Mr. Perfect. I wonder how good in comparison he matches up to being a good husband. What's going to create a court situation, put Steve on the dock, and then put him on trial? After lots of research, either I'm more like Barrett Holmes than Sherlock Holmes, or this man is a freak. I've literally found nothing on him. I've had emails, texts and conversations with people describing him as watertight, clean as a whistle. Boys want to be him and girls want to be on him. What you see is what you get. I think I've made it perfectly clear. The handsome, polite, ambitious, adventurous, friendly, successful, humble man who lives in Asia, who you see before you, sorry not me, is heinously guilty of being Mr. Perfect. You have been head boy, a rugby internationalist, a national sprint champion, a Scottish rugby champion. You've travelled the world, successful businessman, a great brother and son. As MC Hammer said, just can't touch
this. Touch this.
Whoops. Anyway, despite Steve being so squeaky clean, sometimes these great traits which he possesses can backfire. In 2003, a young Steve headed to South Africa with Glasgow Hawks. One day the players decided to go shark diving with the Great Whites. Steve decided to be the enthusiastic guy that he is and be the first one in the water and take one for the team, proving at 4:30 a.m. that he can be tough and macho. This ended up with Steve having a once-in-a-lifetime experience as one of the players decided to relieve himself, flushing the entire contents of the boat's toilets into the water while Steve was trapped in the cage. I'll leave the rest of it up to your imagination. Let's just say, this time, Steve, you didn't come up smelling of roses. Who said being perfect is always a good thing? Stephen, you truly are a fantastic friend and person. Gifted in more ways than one can imagine. You never cease to amaze me or anyone else sitting around here. And again, he's proved today he's conquered another landmark by securing Laura for the rest of his life. Laura, I remember meeting you for the first time, and Steve asking me, what do you think, what do you think, what do you think? I was like, calm down, as he was super excited, knowing you were a keeper and wanted reassurance, or maybe just trying to make me jealous. You really are perfect, like the last piece of the Stephen Neil Gordon jigsaw. On behalf of the Gordon family, I welcome you to being a Gordon. I don't know what the feeling of that is like, but I'm positive it's nothing like being a McClay, and definitely not a Bannerman. But we're sure you'll get used to it pretty quickly and adopt it with pride. As you grow up, you see your friends pair off and gain other halves. Sometimes you gain a friend, sometimes not. It really is more than that with Laura. She truly makes you feel like another one of her best friends. So, it now gives me immense pleasure to invite you all to stand once more and raise your glasses in a toast to love, life, laughter, and happily ever after, Laura and Steve. Thank you very much, guys.
So get in the car, you can ride it wherever you want. Get inside it, and you wanna steer. But I'm shifting gears, I'll take it from here. Oh yeah, yeah, and it goes like this. Take me by the tongue and I'll know you. Kiss me till you're drunk and I'll show you all the moves like Jagger. I've got the moves like Jagger. I've got the moves.
Here for your beautiful bride and groom, please. Can we invite the wedding party to the dance floor, please? Steven Lowe, please!